everyone, welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, my name is Penny. I am a master esthetician in Portland, Oregon, and I'm excited that you're here with me today, you guys, because it's time for the Friday Q&A. This is a video that I'm doing every single week where I try to take as many of your comments and your questions and answer them in one video. So without further ado, you guys, I have so many good questions this week. I want to just get right into it. First one is from Hey G. This one says, hi Penny, is it okay to nano Cos De Baha Niacinamide serum? They also say, I also have retinol serum from the same company. Could I use it after the channels are closed from the actual microneedling session? It's a great question. Now, what you need to remember is that nano infusion, using that device with a nano cartridge on it, is working very, very superficially. So I've been asked what nano actually means. I did do a video on it. I will link that video. But in a nutshell, it uses a tip that basically has all these little, a third the size of a hair cones on this little tiny tip that are able to kind of separate the cells of your stratum corneum, which is the very outermost layer of your skin. And it kind of allows whatever you've put down on your skin, in this case, niacinamide, to slide in a little bit deeper. Our skin is a fantastic barrier. That's what it's there for. It's there to keep things out and then also keep things in, right? So with nano, we're just trying to kind of, you know, open the door a little and get our whatever we want into that outermost layer a little bit more. Niacinamide is a fantastic ingredient. It is vitamin B3. It is great for your pores. It is great for pigment. It helps with inhibiting pigment. It also helps with your barrier function. It is just a wonderful vitamin. And yes, it is great nanoed in. Now, it depends on which product from Cos De Baha you're talking about. If you're talking about their serum that is a 10% niacinamide, you really want to cut that with something. 10% niacinamide is typically supposed to be used as a booster, whereas 5% niacinamide is perfect. That's the sweet spot. That is the best for anti-aging, for your pores, for your barrier, all of that stuff. So if you have a 10% niacinamide, like the one from Cos De Baha, mix it with a little bit of hyaluronic acid and you should be fine. Now, if you decide to go ahead and just try and use it all by itself, just watch for irritation. People definitely can experience irritation from niacinamide, flushing and just general irritation. So just watch for that. If you find that you get irritated, don't nano that in anymore because it's definitely something that can be irritating. Now, the second part of your question is about using retinol after you have microneedled once the channels are closed. And the answer to that question is yes, yes, yes. In the book, Dermal Needling by Dr. Lance Setterfield, he definitely says vitamin A in the days post microneedling, the more vitamin A, the better. It's actually called for. What I like to convey to you guys at home, and this is super important, is always to watch for irritation. Irritation is one of those things that when it cascades out of control, it's a big, big negative for our skin, for inflammation, for possible post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. So you just want to be mindful of how your skin feels, but know that vitamin A is very, very good once the channels are closed to apply topically post microneedling. So yes, you definitely can use that once those channels are closed. Okay, next question is from Barbara Steffenhagen, and this is a big one, you guys. She says, can you clarify the difference between EGF and stem cells? Now guys, this could be a whole entire video series on its own, right? I'm gonna try and take it down to a nutshell in this Friday Q&A. And basically, you guys, stem cells are like mother cells. They are undifferentiated cells, meaning they're the kind of cells that can become anything that they need to become in your body. So for example, stem cells that are produced in our bone marrow, let's say, they travel throughout our body and they just go where they're needed and they differentiate, they rejuvenate and they repair all kinds of cells, wherever they're needed, right? Growth factors, on the other hand, are a component of stem cells. So they're a part of stem cells. Now, lots and lots of cells in our bodies also do produce growth factors. And those growth factors do different things. But what you need to know is that stem cells are like a blank canvas that can become whatever they need to become. And growth factors are large proteins that are messengers. They go around telling cells what to do. They interact with that cell, they come to their receptor and they lock in and they say, hey, fibroblast, produce some collagen. So that's what a growth factor does. It is a messenger cell that tells other cells what to do. A stem cell is a blank canvas that can become whatever kind of cell it needs to become. Now, an analogy that I kind of came up with, and hopefully this doesn't confuse things, is when you microneedle your skin, because I think that that's what a lot of people are thinking about, is obviously skincare when we're talking about stem cells and growth factors. When you microneedle your skin, it is an injury in our body, and inflammation results from that. That's part of the wound healing process. And it's very, very necessary because we're doing this to induce the wound healing process, which kicks off this whole cascade that eventually leads to collagen production. Okay, so inflammation calls 911 and the stem cell, which is the ambulance, picks up. And the driver of that ambulance is the growth factor, okay? So you can imagine if you were in your house and you broke your leg and you called the ambulance would show up and their team inside that ambulance with all of the accoutrements in the ambulance would come in and they would do what they had to do to begin fixing your leg, right? Well, if Sally Joe down the street called 911 because she had a sugar crash, ambulance, that stem cell, is able to go to whatever site it needs to and repair and rejuvenate the cells at that site, depending on what they need, okay? Carrying with it, though, is a component. All the things in the ambulance that are gonna fix stuff, one of those things is growth factors. So you just need to know that growth factors are a component of stem cells. And stem cells are everything. They're the mother of all of it. They can become everything. Everything about us was once a stem cell. And it has differentiated into your liver and your heart and your skin and your eyes, everything, right? Now, growth factors are signaling proteins. They're messenger proteins. And I do think that there is great value in growth factors in skincare. I do think that you can topically put growth factors on, especially when there's a lot of research and development behind whatever specific growth factor you have chosen. And what happens is, even though they're too big to actually penetrate your skin, they're able to send messages down deeper into your skin, asking the cells in your dermis to create more growth factors. They're able to basically play telephone from the surface of your skin into the deeper layers of your skin. So they don't actually have to physically penetrate your skin to work, which is why I think that growth factors are just so cool. And so stem cells and growth factors are definitely very different. If I had to say to you, what should you look for? Growth factors all the way. So many of the stem cells that you see in cosmeceuticals, you guys, are apple stem cells. We see that one a lot. There's a lot of different fruit and flower stem cells, but you see a lot of apple stem cells. Now, apple stem cells are amazing for apples, okay? Flower stem cells, they're amazing for flowers. They don't jump species. You're not going to get stem cell collagen production or proliferation, rejuvenation in a human from an apple. You're just not gonna get that. Now, that's not to say that there's no value in apple stem cells. Apple stem cells can be probably hydrating and they may be amazing antioxidants. They may have profound value that way. But I think the word stem cell is kind of being manipulated to make us think that it is the kind of stem cell that comes from humans that is able to, you know, differentiate into different tissues in our body and repair and, you know, that kind of thing, because it's not the same thing. It's not the same thing at all. If you guys would like a dedicated video on stem cells and on growth factors, you know, like a bigger, it probably would be a series. I am definitely happy to just kind of dissect it and go through it. And hopefully I didn't confuse things today with this. This next one is from Chrissy Buck. She says, Penny, I love you and your vids. Thanks, Chrissy, that's really nice. I would love to know if I can microneedle with CBD, HA, and CBD peptide serum. Okay, so the answer to that is no. The only thing that we can microneedle with at home, you guys. Now, in office, we use different things that are specifically made MD versions that I have to work with a doctor to get my hands on, and it is called Antiage. It is specifically made for microneedling, and it is specifically designed to be needled in and not cause our body to think that a foreign body has been needled in. The deal with microneedling hyaluronic acid, you guys, is that our body naturally produces hyaluronic acid, and so it recognizes it. That's why we're able to get fillers with hyaluronic acid, and our body doesn't reject it. So there's that component. Our body's going to recognize it, and it's going to be okay with it typically. The high molecular weight part, you guys, is because it's anti-inflammatory. You put those two components together and you have the perfect thing for microneedling at home. You have an anti-inflammatory substance that our body recognizes, reducing the risk of something called granulomas. I'm going to put a picture of a granuloma up here. This is something that you definitely do not want. This is from Dr. Lance Setterfield's dermal needling site. I will link that in the description box. Certainly want to give credit there. But this is what can happen when the body thinks that whatever we have needled in is a foreign substance and we end up with granulomas. You don't want that. It's not worth it. You know, you only have to wait a few hours and the channels will be closed, and then you can use your peptide creams. Then you can go ahead and use your CBD, all of that kind of stuff. You just want those channels to be closed. You do not want to potentially, you know, convince your body that you've just needled something in that it doesn't want. And next thing you know, you have these irreversible granulomas. That would be not good. So stick with high molecular weight hyaluronic acid only when you're microneedling at home. Okay, next question is from Donna Pepper. And she says, Penny, I have a question. I am microneedling and using a microcurrent. I do the needling once a month. Can I do microcurrent in between? Yes, absolutely. That is so fantastic. So here's the deal. With microneedling, of course, we're trying to induce collagen. That's what we're doing. We are making our body think that it's been traumatized, it's been injured. It starts in the wound healing process, which the result of all of that is collagen production. That is for our skin health. It helps with cell-to-cell communication. It just overall helps with making our skin healthier. Microcurrent, on the other hand, works on our muscles. So something completely different. And by using microcurrent, you're actually stimulating something called adenosine triphosphate. That is like the life source in our cells. It's also known as ATP. Now, that's something completely different than collagen stimulation, although they are related, you guys, but you're coming at it from a completely different source. You're working on muscles, you're working on skin. Yes, you absolutely can. Now, what I would say, and like I say with a lot of these procedures when you're trying to time them with microneedling, is I would probably wait about a week after I microneedled medically to reintroduce my microcurrent. And that is just because that skin needs time to heal. It needs time to retexturize. It just needs time to do what we've just kind of set off to do with microneedling. Now, you could microcurrent right up until you microneedle. If you microcurrent on the same day that you microneedle before microneedling, you would definitely want to double or triple cleanse your skin and make sure all that conductivity gel is off of your face and your face is clean. You don't want to be needling that into your skin. So that's the only caveat, but those two treatments are fantastic together, and that's awesome that you're doing that. Next question is from Lindsay M, and she says, hi Penny, you mentioned a shampoo and conditioner line that does not contain protein. Could you please tell me the name of that brand again? Yes, it is called Aqua. It is actually a line of hair care that is designed for hair extensions. And if you're new around here, I am actually an extension hair extension specialist, and I educate for salon services for hair extensions. And they sell Aqua at the Professional Beauty Supply. Recently, we as stylists are able to become an affiliate basically with salon services and allow you to shop at our Professional Beauty Supply. So it's pretty cool because you will notice across the last 3 years, I haven't talked a ton about hair care because it's kind of hard to direct people where to go. Wherever you live, you may not have access to some of the things that salon services sells. So it's pretty cool that now I can link that. But what is good for you is that you know that it's authentic, it's not expired, and it's basically, it is the exact same Professional Beauty Supply where I shop probably once a week for my hair stuff. The last question is from Jody, and she says, hi Penny, I wanted to ask how long after microneedling does your skin absorb more product? I'm going to follow what you wrote, but when you go back to your own routine, is your skin still absorbing more? She says, thank you. And you're welcome, Jody. Okay, so this is such a good question, you guys. Now, listen, those channels close up pretty quickly, you guys. I mean, between 15 minutes and a couple hours, for sure. I mean, depending on the depth that you have done, for sure, by the next morning, the channels are closed if you did it the night before. So what I usually say is, A, you want to make sure that the channels are closed. So you want to wait a couple hours at least. And that goes back to the granuloma thing. We just don't want anything introduced into those channels that might cause our body to think that there's a foreign substance coming in and it has to defend itself. We don't want to do that. Now, the second reason why I like to give it a little bit of time is because we've got so much going on. We're retexturizing. We just poked a bunch of holes. Anything super active might cause a little bit of excessive irritation. And excessive irritation leads to more inflammation. Too much inflammation is aging. So you just want to be kind of nice to your skin. Now, I have had people, you know, really comment about how their skin gets way too dry. So I will say that you're using hyaluronic acid only. If you wait a couple hours, but before bed on the same day that you microneedle, you definitely can hydrate your skin with more hyaluronic acid and then put an occlusive moisturizer over it to hold that water in so that you can mitigate a little bit of the dryness that can happen with microneedling. So that's like CeraVe. You can definitely use that over hyaluronic acid, you know, a few hours after you've microneedled to ensure that the channels are closed. You're not putting any of that occlusive right over those open channels. And that should help mitigate some of that transepidermal water loss and some of that dehydration, some of that dryness that can be experienced after we've microneedled. So you definitely can do that. Hopefully that answers your question. Going back to your regular routine, usually you just have to judge how your skin feels. If you have a super active routine as far as, you know, alpha hydroxy acids and retin-A and that kind of stuff, I usually just say give your skin a few days. Give it time to truly heal from poking a bunch of holes in it with microneedling pen. So, you know, you kind of got to use your own judgment, but those channels are closed between 15 minutes and a couple hours. So as far as the granuloma part's concerned, you're safe right away. Just have to use your judgment on the activity of the products that you're going to put on your skin and how well your skin will tolerate it and if you're going to cause yourself excessive irritation. I hope that you guys enjoyed this Friday Q&A. If you guys have any specific questions or if you want me to elaborate on any of these subjects, I'm happy to do so. Please keep the questions coming. This is how we do this. And honestly, you guys, it feeds my brain that I get so many of these questions. You guys have the best questions. And it causes me to constantly, you know, just be really thinking and contemplating and researching. And I love it. I love it. It is so fun. So definitely keep those questions coming. Hope you guys have a fantastic weekend. And I will talk to you again very, very soon. Take care.